So in this session, first I will do a quick introduction to integration microservices, and then we'll discuss about challenges when it comes to building integration microservices and solutions for them. And then later on, we'll discuss about how we can build integration microservices using WSO2 technology. Okay, so before we go deep into integration microservices, let me look at what microservices really are. I'm pretty sure that most of you are already familiar with microservices, but just to give a quick recap on the definition, the microservices are a way of building software applications as a collection of independent and autonomous services. So these services we are talking here are business capability oriented, and obviously they are loosely coupled. The key motivation behind introducing this microservices architecture is basically the breaking of the monolithic. So breaking of the monolithic in the sense the elimination of the existing centralized enterprise service bus architecture. So with the elimination of ESB, it was suggested to use smart endpoints and dump pipes. So let's look at what these smart endpoints and dump pipes are. Okay, so before we move into smart endpoints and dump pipes, so let me take a step back and see the existing centralized or ESB style integration architecture. So as you can see in this picture, so we have different systems, data, applications, and services. So we need to integrate these different systems and application and data. So what we do is we bring in a component called an ESB, the enterprise service bus, into the middle and do all kind of wiring between these services and systems with the ESB. So at the ESB, you will do all kinds of integration logic. You could do transformation, routing, filtering, all kinds of integration stuff can be happen at the integration layer. So at the ESB, what you expose is a service that consumers can consume. But in modern centralized architecture, we are not directly exposing those virtual services created at the ESB. Rather, we bring in another layer called the API management layer, where you can apply different kinds of quality of stuff aspect into the services that you have exposed over ESB. So basically, you could apply security, throttling, and also the monetization stuff can happen at the API management layer. So at the API management layer, you are exposing a managed API for your consumers. So this architecture works pretty well for most of the organizations. So even though this works well, there are some limitations. So limitations are mainly due to the centralized nature of this architecture. So it's when it comes to agility, there are if you want to introduce a new solution, how quickly you can do it? And how can you scale components individually? So there are problems related to that. And also when it comes to containers and container orchestration frameworks like Kubernetes, so these centralized architectures does not go hand in hand with those deployments as well. So because of these problems, a new architectural style got emerged. So in microservices architecture, what we have is a set of services interconnected to each other. So in here, there's no central layer that control the integration. So rather, we have set of services that is interconnected to each other. So in previous case, what we had was a centralized component. We can call it as a smart pipe. But in this case, we don't have a smart pipe. Rather, we have a smart set of smart endpoints connected through some dump channels. So basically, this is these channels are called dump pipes. These interconnection can happen directly over protocols like HTTP, and also this interconnection can happen through event brokers as well. So this event broker is just a dumb broker that does the interconnection between two different services. Okay, so having that many services, having to integrate that many services, you will be facing problems related to this connections and communication. So basically, when number of services get increased, it's somewhat hard to manage. So the problem here, the problem we are facing here is that, so here in this architecture, we don't have the abstractions coming from the ESP layer. So in the previous architecture, you are provided with all the abstraction at the ESP layer to make the integration much easier. But in this architecture, everything has to be done at each of these services. That's why we call them as smart endpoints. So basically, all the integration logic plus the business logic has to be happen at these endpoints. So even though we position microservices architecture is a way of making stuff more easier, the integration problem equally exists in this as well. So in the centralized architecture, the integration happens at a central component. So in this architecture, that integration is integration problem is distributed across different individual services. So this picture is taken from Uber. So basically, this is drawn from one of their tracing tools. So you could see that there are multiple services, and also there are number of interaction between each of these services. So this is somewhat similar to the spaghetti integration pattern we used to have in pre-ESP era. So that's why we actually have to be extra careful when it comes to designing integration microservices. Okay, the integration of microservices is somewhat hard, so people try to solve that problem by introducing various stuff. So introduction of service mesh is one such attempt. So in service mesh, what we have is a sidecar that sits alongside with the microservice, and we can offload some of this integration stuff into this sidecar. So things like security, client-side load balancing, resiliency stuff like circuit breaking, timeouts. So those stuff can be offloaded into this sidecar. So these sidecars are controlled through a central control plane. So there's a misconception that this service mesh is equal to a distributed ESB or not. So basically, even though we can offload some of the functionalities like security or the resiliency stuff into this sidecar, the actual service composition logic has to happen at the microservices layer. So basically, let's say you have you need to integrate with three different services, service A, B, and C. So if you want to call them in a sequential manner, you have to write that composition logic at the microservices level. So you can't offload that responsibility to the sidecar. So that's why the service mesh is not equal to a distributed ESP. So even though the service mesh makes stuff more easier, it also introduced some other problems too. So basically, So basically, as you can see in this diagram, so when you introduce a service mesh, so the number of instances get increased, and also all the network communication has to happen through an extra hop. Okay, so if we try to map all these concepts into a typical deployment diagram, we'll end up with something like this. So here at the bottom, we have atomic microservices. So basically, it takes care of all the core business logic. And next, we have the integration microservices, so which basically do composition of multiple microservices. And then on top of these microservices layer, then you have the API services or the edge services layer. They are where you have the API gateways. So there can be one or multiple API gateways depending on your requirement. So the APIs exposed by the gateway layer can be consumed by the consumers. So you can integrate this architecture, this system with existing legacy systems or existing SaaS applications through the interfaces exposed by those systems. Okay, so now let's talk about building smart endpoints with integration microservices. So the first thing would be to find the right granularity. So if you have thousands of services, and unless you are a mega cloud or a large enterprise which provides number of business capabilities, having that many services gives an idea that you have followed a too fine-grained approach. So the idea is that scoping your service around a business capability. So the Uber came up with this a new model called the domain-oriented microservices architecture. So basically, they are talking about scoping the microservices for a particular domain. So they had a problem where, so if some in their system, they used to have thousands of microservices. So if something goes wrong, to troubleshoot a problem, an engineer has to work through 50 different services across 12 different teams. So that's complex and that's not that simple. So that's not what you expect from the microservices architecture. So when you find the right granularity, then you need to look for a technology that can be used to build integration microservices. So the technology that we are going to use for building integration microservices has to provide proper abstractions. So basically, if that technology can provide proper abstractions that can take care of inter-service communication, then the developers can focus on their development, their actual business logic, rather than focusing on inter-service communication. So basically, a technology that used to build microservices should provide support to well-known protocols and standards, things like HTTP, gRPC, WebSockets. And so supporting those are essential, but also it's good to have abstractions for supporting various SaaS applications, various well-known SaaS applications like Salesforce, and also proprietary systems like SAP and some of the legacy systems. So if you have abstractions for integrating directly with those systems, that made the developer life more easier. Okay, then we have the different service composition factor. The first one is active composition, where you actively compose your integrations. So this is called service orchestration. So basically, let's say you have three different services, service A, B, and C. So if you want to call these services, you can call the service A and get the response, call the service B, get the response. So likewise, in here, you are actively compositioning. You are doing the composition logic actively. So and the other approach is the reactive approach. So in the reactive approach, the services are listening for events. So when it receive an event, it do something based on the event and emit another event. So that's the reactive approach. And there are some other approaches and patterns like event sourcing, CQRS. So I'm not going to touch on those today. Okay, so the microservices architecture go hand in hand with containers and container orchestration frameworks. So having native support for containers, Docker and container orchestration framework like Kubernetes is an added advantage. So when it comes to containers, so the technology that we are selecting to build the integration microservices should have some key features. So the fast boot up time and low memory consumption is essential. So apart from that, so these container orchestration frameworks like Kubernetes provide SDKs and APIs that gives flexibility to natively integrate your integration technology with those systems. So say for example, the Kubernetes has the operator SDK that you can use to build Kubernetes operators. So if your integration technology provider or the technology that you are going to use to build integration microservices provide those operators, is going to be a really good advantage when it comes to dealing with the deployment. Okay, so if you are coming from an enterprise integration background, I'm pretty sure almost all of you are familiar with enterprise integration patterns. So even though these enterprise integration patterns are designed for centralized ESB style architecture, most of these patterns are equally valid for microservices as well. So stuff like forking, joining, split, aggregation. So all these are equally valid for microservices architecture as well. So the only difference is that all the EIPs or the enterprise integration patterns are implemented at the central ESB component in the centralized architecture. But in here, some of those are implemented at the microservices level or the smart endpoint. And some are implemented at the platform level, at the container orchestration framework like Kubernetes. As we all know, networks are not reliable. So network is not going to be reliable forever. So when it comes to designing integration microservices, we need to take that into account. So as we discussed previously, service mesh take care of this resiliency aspect. So resiliency stuff related to circuit breaking, retrying, timeout, bulkhead, those are taken care of by the service mesh. But not all deployment has this service mesh component in their deployment. So basically, if the technology that we are going to use for building integration microservices can provide this abstraction, that's going to be an added advantage. Okay, so in microservices architecture, we are dealing with hundreds of services. So it's obvious that we are to integrate these hundreds of services, we have to mix and match stuff. So we have to do matching between different message formats. So we have to do transformations. We have to deal with different kind of schemas. So having a very good, powerful or tools to do these kind of mapping is essential for a technology provider. So basically, it's not all about programmatically implementing these different kinds of conversions. It's good to have the visual tools that you can get the inputs and outputs and do mappings. So having powerful tools for doing complex type conversion is very important. Okay, so now let's look at how we can use WSUDO technology to build integration microservices. As we all know, WSU2 Enterprise Integrator is the product that we have in our product stack. for building integration solutions. So Enterprise Integrator is an API-centric, cloud-native, and distributed integration platform that can cater for both microservices and centralized integration patterns. So both are supported. So apart from the key integration capabilities, so it has support for data integration, as well as new emerging integration technologies like streaming integration. And it's highly extensible. So we have a number of integration connectors that you can plug into the core component and extend the integration capabilities. So when it comes to microservices integration, the Enterprise Integrator provide a unique low-code approach. So basically, you will be provided with an integrated development environment where you can use it for graphically design your integration. And also, this Enterprise Integrator has native support for container orchestration frameworks like Kubernetes and Docker. So it gets well integrated into these ecosystems. And also, fast boot up time and the low resource consumption make it ideal for the microservices architecture. So if you are familiar with WSO2 products, so we used to have a product called WSO2 Enterprise Service Bus. The Enterprise Integrator is the successor of Enterprise Service Bus product. So basically the Enterprise Integrator uses the same integration runtime we used to have in ESB, which means that this Enterprise Integrator can be deployed as an Enterprise Service Bus into any solution. So it supports almost all the enterprise integration patterns, and it supports various, almost all the well-known protocols and standards. The streaming integration is a new emerging technology. So basically we have the Enterprise Integrator got a component called the Streaming Integrator, which is solely focused on the streaming stuff. So basically, the Streaming Integrator can listen for event streams coming from various event sources and act upon those events and create integrations and build solutions. So basically, we are mainly focusing on change data capture and ETL capabilities. Okay, so all these integrations we talked about can be developed using the visual tooling experience that is provided in Enterprise Integrator. So we are having a tool called the Integration Studio, which you can use to starting from design all the way up to deploying it to some deployment, you can do it through the Integration Studio. So it provides a drag and drop graphical experience where you can develop your integration configuration. And when you want to get started with the integration project immediately, so we Integration Studio provides set of templates. So these templates are available for almost all the well-known patterns. So if you want to get started with your project very quickly, you can select one of these templates and get started. So as I mentioned earlier, having powerful data transformation capabilities is very important when it comes to designing integration microservices. So the Integration Studio provides a visual experience when it comes to doing different data transformation. So here in this picture, you could see that the data mapper tool we have to do mapping between two different messages. So, and also this tool provides support for evaluate your mapping in real time. Okay, so when it comes to testing and debugging, so similar to how we debug code, the programs you've written in any language using an integrated development environment, this Enterprise Integration Studio provide a way to debug and test your integrations while you are developing. So So you could put the breakpoints for different configuration elements that is available in Integration Studio, and then you could debug the flow while you are developing your configuration. And also for testing also, it has built-in capabilities, built-in clients, and all the stuff are integrated into this studio. Okay, so when it comes to integration flows testing, so the Integration Studio has a test framework. So basically you could write unit test cases for each and every configuration that you develop. So, and also that can be integrated to your CI/CD flow as well. Okay, so the connectors. So basically, as I mentioned previously, the WSO2 store has over 250 connectors to connect with all the well-known SaaS applications and most of the proprietary systems. And also you could write your own connector. So this is the way that you could extend the functionality of the integration runtime. Okay, so that's all I need to talk about the enterprise integrator. So I'm pretty sure by now almost everybody is heard of Ballerina. So a Ballerina is a programming language that we have been working on. So it provides a unique way of building smart endpoints and pipe. So you can see there will be a lot of improvements coming in the Ballerina area in near future.